Hello everyone. Today we are going to be talking about the stock market for beginners. We'll give you lots of valuable information, so make sure you take some notes. Let's get started. There are lots of misconceptions about stock market investing, such as this is gambling, the stock market is an exclusive club for brokers and rich people, stocks that go up must come down, that you can't beat the market, that you must avoid volatility and risk. During this video, we'll try to show you that this is not always true. To start, what is a stock? It's a contract that makes you the owner of a fraction of a company. This entitles you to a part of the company's assets and profits. A share is one of these fractions. Now you may ask, how can I buy a stock? The most popular way to buy stocks nowadays is through an online stock broker. This is where you can open your brokerage account and where you can buy and sell shares. The broker you choose depends on what you are looking for. There are brokers that are better for stocks. There are others which are better for stock options, a topic we'll cover in another video. There are others which are better for day trading. Ultimately, you have to find out which best suits your needs. The most popular ones are Fidelity Investments, TD Ameritrade, Robinhood, and others that are popular in Europe, such as Interactive Brokers and DEGIRO. There are different types of investors, such as technical, fundamental, and passive. The technical investors look at indicators, price action, volume, patterns. Basically, technical analysis involves looking at a lot of charts. They don't care if this is a good stock for the future, and they usually try to get in and out of stocks really quickly. Fundamental is the type of analysis we use on this channel. It involves studying everything about a stock. Looking at the financials, the management team, the overall economy, and industry conditions. Basically, it means looking at what this asset is worth and what it may be worth in a few years. This is better for long-term investing. Finally, we have passive investing. This is ideal for you if you don't want to spend a lot of time studying companies. This is an investing strategy in which you put your money in an index fund following something. It could be the S&P 500, which is an index composed of the 500 largest companies in America, the housing market, the tech companies, etc. A lot of people who invest end up losing money. Passive investing can be a solution for a lot of you. The S&P 500 has grown on average 8% per year since its inception. If you invest a set amount every month in the S&P 500, in the long term, you'll end up making money. Another way to have a somewhat passive approach to investing is to invest in dividend stocks. So, what is a dividend stock? We'll cover this on the next topic of this video, which is different types of stocks. Let's get started straight away with dividend stocks. They are usually stocks of large companies that pay you a dividend, usually quarterly. You don't expect the stock to grow that much. You only want that constant paycheck to keep coming. If the company is doing well, it is usual to raise the dividend as time goes by. Then we have growth stocks. And as the name suggests, these are companies that are expected to grow a lot. They normally don't pay dividends, as the earnings are reinvested into future growth. Then we have value stocks, which are stocks that are currently undervalued. Investors look at the stock and realize that its assets are worth more than the stock price. Sometimes they are part of an industry that's not doing so well at the time, but will be just fine in the long run. We have some speculative stocks, which are usually of recent companies with a new product that hasn't been tested yet, and they don't have very solid financials. They may be risky, but the returns you get from these companies, if the company is successful, are going to be huge. Then you have blue chip stocks. They are shares of very large companies with good growth history and solid growth prospects. Although not something exponential, it's a good solid growth in the long term. They are normally expensive but provide low risk. Blue chip stocks are stocks such as Apple, Disney, Microsoft, etc. Finally, we have penny stocks, which are stocks that cost less than $5. They are usually small companies looking for financing. They are very risky, and small moves in the stock price lead to huge percentage gains or losses. The next part of this video is where should you look for information? And the answer is everywhere. Whether it's in a YouTube video, the local newspaper, or a large news network. One really important rule: never buy a stock just because someone else is buying. Doesn't matter if it is Warren Buffett, one of the greatest investors of all time, Cathie Wood, one of the best modern investors, or even John from your grocery store. Repeat with me: I won't buy a stock simply because someone else is buying. You have to do your own due diligence and research the companies you are investing in. This is your own hard-earned money, so you are the one who must decide. Now, some places we go to when looking for information about stocks. Firstly, Yahoo Finance. It's a really good website to see some brief info about the company, where you can see what is the business of this company, how the price has evolved, some ratios, and the company's financials. Then we have Seeking Alpha, which is an app or a website. In this app, you can create a portfolio of the stocks you have interest in. Then it will send you notifications about these companies you follow. These notifications may be the latest news, such as new contracts, new earnings, the latest upgrade or downgrade that this stock has had. They can also be opinion articles written by analysts. Then you have the investor relations. This is where you can find everything about the company. I know it can be tough at first, but reading the 10Ks and 10Qs, which are the annual and quarterly filings, and listening to the conference calls is really important. This may be one of the main catalysts for my recent returns. YouTube is also a very good platform to listen to other opinions about stocks and to learn about new stocks out there. Take everything with a pinch of salt though. You must do your own due diligence. Then we have the CNBC app or its news channel. It's good to know what is happening in the stock market as a whole. And you should also have another news hub or news channel, so you know what is happening in the world, which is not stock related. Then you should also have a stock tracker. This is an app where you build a watch list of stocks you own, stocks you might be interested in buying, and other stocks to watch out for. This keeps you updated and helps you catch great opportunities in the market. Now we'll talk about risk management, which is one of the most important things about investing. Firstly, don't invest your money if you can't afford to lose it. And don't invest your money if you need it right now or in the near future. After you find the amount of money you are comfortable investing, you need to decide how you want to split it up between different companies. You want to diversify your portfolio. You should not invest in only one stock. As the saying goes, don't put all your eggs in one basket. If something happens to this stock, you might suffer severe losses. Remember, nothing is guaranteed in the stock market. So if you believe a lot in this one company, you should not invest all your money on it. The same goes for different sectors. For example, if you really believe that electric vehicles are the future, so you invest all your money in 3 or 4 different stocks in this sector. If something happens that goes against the electric vehicle industry, you will lose a lot of money because you are only invested in this one sector. On the other hand, you don't want to over-diversify. If your portfolio has 50, 100, or even 200 stocks, you are capping your potential gains. If you do this, you might as well invest in a low-cost index fund that tracks the S&P 500 or some other sector. Another reason for not being in so many stocks is the following. As previously mentioned, you want to know the companies you are invested in from top to bottom, from their balance sheet to their management team, from their income statement to the markets they operate in, from their strengths to their weaknesses, from their opportunities to their threats. You can't possibly know all this about so many companies. Therefore, you should keep this number reasonably low. In our opinion, the ideal number of companies or different stocks you should have is something between 8 and 15. This allows you to be diversified and doesn't cap your gains. Now, some ratios that can be really important in your stock analysis. Well, we have only chosen a few. We'll probably do another video about this later, but some of the most important ones are the quick ratio, which is the current assets minus the inventories divided by the current liabilities. The earnings per share, or EPS, is the net income divided by the outstanding shares. The PE ratio is the price to earnings ratio, which divides the stock price by the earnings per share. This is a very good one to compare stocks in the same sector to see which one is overvalued. And then the debt to equity ratio, which divides the total liabilities by the shareholders' equity. Now, this is probably one of the parts you are most interested in this video, and it is, when should you buy a stock? There are two main ways used by long-term investors to get in a stock. The first is getting in when the stock dips. What is this? Is when the stock price declines in the short term. For example, when there is a correction or even a crash, some companies might get undervalued. This could be a possibility to buy stocks you love when they are for sale. And everyone likes to buy things when they are for sale. This happened in March-April of 2020, and that was a period when we added heavy into our positions. Some downsides of this strategy is that you have to be really patient to hold a large chunk of your money that could be invested in something else. The other common way to buy a stock is by dollar cost averaging. This is when, for example, you add $100 to your portfolio every month, regardless of the price the stock is trading at. So, if the price is high, you buy. If the price is low, you also buy. This is an easier way to invest, but it is better for the more passive investor. Our strategy is a combination of the previous two. We have some aspects of dollar cost averaging, such as we take a set portion of our income every month to invest. We normally add to our positions every month, as we believe that there are always good companies out there that are undervalued. You just have to do your own research. Moreover, it has been shown that more money has been lost by not investing due to a fear of a crash than in an actual stock market crash. However, We always have some cash available in our brokerage account if a correction or crash happens. Because, as it was previously mentioned, who doesn't like a good sale? Now, you may ask, how long should I hold a stock? There are two different ways of investing. The first one is long-term investing. This is when you buy a stock and hold it for more than a year. The strategy in this case is to wait for the stock's value to rise over an extended period of time, which requires patience and the ability to overlook short-term fluctuations in value. The ongoing performance of the stock is more important than recent ups and downs in value, especially for a stock that is held for several years. Then you have short-term trading. This is when you watch the stock market for opportunities to buy low and sell high. Most traders are looking for a quick way to take advantage of short-term fluctuations in the market. If a stock is held for less than a year before being sold, it's categorized as a short-term trade. This type of trading comes with potential for easy profit, but it also comes with risk. Low-priced stocks may not rise in value over the short term, or they may actually lose value. This type of trading involves a lot of risk, so if you are to do this, do it when you are young and have time to recover from it. Some considerations. Although sometimes you might get a quick profit from a stock, in this channel we advocate for long-term investing. It has been proven that over the long run, long-term investing is more profitable. The saying goes, let short-term traders get the breadcrumbs as long-term investors will get the whole bread. Now, you've bought a stock, you must know when to sell. We suggest you hold stocks for the long term in this channel, as you probably have already noticed. However, it is important to know when should you sell a stock. Firstly, if you need that money for something else, such as paying deals, debt, etc., although this shouldn't happen as you only should be investing the money you don't need right away and money that you can afford to lose. Another reason to sell is when the fundamentals of a company have changed. If for some reason, the business you invested into is not the same anymore and is actually worse, sell that stock. This could mean you sell it for a profit or a loss. I know it can be tough for some of you to sell a stock when you are losing money. However, sometimes it is better to accept this loss than turn it into something larger. When you feel there are better investment portfolios elsewhere, you should sell your stocks and get onto those investments. And the final reason is when you need to rebalance your portfolio. If one of your stocks has had a huge run-up, you might want to sell a part of your position. For example, if one of your stocks was about 10% of your portfolio, but it grew so much that it is now 50% of your portfolio, you should consider selling a portion of this position, as now you are too dependent on the performance of this one stock. You may ask us, how much should I invest? It varies from person to person. $1,000 can be a lot for someone and a very small amount to others. Just remember, invest an amount you are comfortable with. And you should also have an emergency fund set up before you start investing. Congratulations, you have just begun your investment journey in the stock market. Leave a like if you enjoyed this video and subscribe so you don't miss the next videos.